Bibles there. You're welcome to do that. Let me know when we're ready, folks.
Good?
Yep. I'm going to be entitling this message tonight, "Am I My Brother's Keeper?" And tonight's going to be pretty heavy duty. It's going to be heavy duty. God gave me a message on, he woke me up about, I don't know what time, Monday morning, and he gave me this message. And I was contemplating, can I remember it, or should I jump up and actually get up early in the morning and get it done? And so I got up and grabbed my iPad and went to work. And it's called, "Am I My Brother's Keeper?" And I'm starting in Genesis chapter 4. I'm going to pray first. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening and this opportunity to come and hear the Word of God. Father, we thank you for your Word, that it is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. Heavenly Father, Lord, we ask you to touch this time. God, that you would touch the hearts of the hearers of your Word. Father, Lord, that we would be doers and not only hearers of your Word tonight. Father, Lord God, I just pray that you would anoint this time by the Holy Spirit of God. Anoint my lips to speak as the very oracle of God tonight, Father. Thank you for this privilege and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And amen. Genesis chapter 4. And let me see what verse is on that. Genesis 4, 8 through 9, 8 and 9. And it says this: "One day Cain suggested to his brother, 'Let's go out in the fields.' And while they were in the fields, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Afterwards, the Lord asked Cain, 'Where is your brother? Where is Abel?' 'I don't know.'" He had an attitude. "'I don't know,' Cain responded. 'Am I my brother's guy? Am I my brother's guardian?'" he asked. That's the New Living Translation. Yours may say, "Am I my brother's keeper?"
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
And I thought that was a good, because tonight I'm talking about, I entitled it, "Am I My Brother's Keeper?" But what I'm talking about tonight is I'm talking about a word called loyalty.
Amen.
You don't hear it very often.
That's right.
You don't hear it, especially in the churches.
Right.
Loyalty is, and I'll give you a definition in just a minute, but I'm going to tell you some stuff tonight. It's pretty heavy duty, man. You know, the reason I knew loyalty is because I was raised and I was brought up a gang member.
Yeah.
And gang members, you know what I mean, they know loyalty, even though it's wrong loyalty.
Yeah.
And it costs them their blood. Right around here, we have, just down the street right here, we have bloodshed of a young gang member. Just right up the street, another young gang member's blood. There's blood all over this Pueblo City.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
Of loyal gang members who gave their lives and who understand a concept, amen, of loyalty.
Yeah.
Who understand, "I'm willing to spill my blood for you." Yeah. This is something I believe that the church don't understand.
That's right.
I come from that mindset. You with me?
Yeah.
That loyalty is everything. And but you know what I mean? Even in the church, you know, you get a lot of people who want to go to church and kind of, you know, do what they want, attend when they want, and different stuff like that, and don't realize, wait a minute, well, you know what I mean? Your loyalty doesn't start here at the church.
Right.
Your loyalty starts with your commitment with God.
Right.
And the last I knew, right over there, some of you could see the cross.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's loyalty right there. That's loyalty to you. That Jesus spilled his blood on the cross for you. He died for you. He committed to you. And he didn't use duct tape and rope. He used nails. And he hung himself. They didn't hang him there. He said, "You don't take my life. I lay my life down." That's loyalty. Loyalty is something that I don't know. I don't know if you can teach loyalty. It's got to be in your heart. If you really know the Lord and you really have accepted Christ, you're going to know what true loyalty is. It's just something in your DNA, your spiritual DNA, that you're willing to spill your blood. You're willing, you love your brothers and sisters so much that you're willing to even spill your blood for them.
Yeah.
You're willing to spill your blood for the cause of Christ. Amen? You look in the Bible, you look in Hebrews 11, and you see by faith these people were torn asunder, were sawed in half, were doing all this and refused to deny Christ. That's loyalty. That's something we do not know these days.
Yeah.
You with me?
Right.
And you know, I mean, it trips me out because I knew it in the gangs. We had homies that were willing to die for us and us the same.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
But in the church, we're so offended. We're so hurt with one another.
Yeah.
We're willing to divorce our husbands, our wives. We're willing to abandon our kids if they don't listen. We're willing to quit our jobs at the drop of a hat. Come on now. Because we do not understand what loyalty is. See, it even affects the smallest things like your attitude at work.
Yeah.
That'll tell if you're really a Christian or not.
Yep.
What tells if you're really a Christian or not is not that you can, you know, suffer because you did something wrong. It's suffer in the face of being innocent.
Right. Yep.
Come on now.
Right.
Being innocent, not even having done nothing. You with me? And being willing to suffer through that. You know, the Bible says if you're suffering because you sold or you did this or did that and they put you in jail, that's one thing. But if you're suffering and you didn't even do nothing wrong, there's pastors that are being put in jail these days.
Right.
One just happened recently in our nation. Put in jail for preaching the gospel. Did nothing wrong but speak. I thought the last time I looked in our constitution, that you had a freedom of speech.
Yeah.
How do you not have a freedom of speech in your own church?
Right.
And they're putting them in jail and they're doing this and that. See, the thing is what teaches you loyalty, I believe, is persecution.
Yeah.
Hard times will make you decide whose side you're on. You with me? Am I with the Lord? You know, because many people, they are Christian and this and that, but wait till you have to suffer.
Yeah.
Wait till you have to go through some things. Wait till they're talking about you.
Yeah.
As long as they're talking about your pastor on Facebook, it don't bother you because it ain't doing you nothing, no harm. But the moment they're talking about you, you with me?
That's
a different story.
Right, man.
You wanna fight your battle and you wanna tell them it's not true.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
But loyalty is something, you know, that's heavy duty. But I want to share some stuff with you because this is something God put in my heart. God dropped this in, and I even freaked out about it because He was bringing some stuff up and saying, "Hey, look what you've been through. Look what has happened to you." He said, "But you know what? You know what I mean? He was teaching me on loyalty, but that's something that you need to learn tonight, if it's possible to be, and I'm sure it is."
Right.
You with me?
Right.
Because I learned to be a gang member and I learned to be willing to lay down my life for my homeboys.
Right.
You with me?
Yeah.
And I'll show you what I'm talking about. Joseph's brothers abandoned him in a well and even sold him into slavery to traitors. You with me? Traitors that were, you know, I mean, as much opposite as you can get. They were the very ones that were, you know, remember when Abraham had Isaac and Ishmael?
Right.
The Ishmael was the son of the flesh. Ishmael was the handmaiden's son. That he had no right over there with his handmaiden.
That's right.
You with me? And yet he went with her because the wife, and sometimes you gotta understand this, sometimes even in your own life, you're gonna make decisions that ain't God.
Right.
She said, "Well, maybe because I can't have children, maybe we should do it through my handmaiden." And so, honey, go ahead, honey. Honey, he was already with her.
Yeah.
She was young and beautiful. His wife was older. And
yeah.
And you with me?
Yeah.
And he went with his handmaiden and had a baby right away.
Yeah.
But God said, "Hey, wait a minute, what are you doing? I never told you to do that."
Right.
You got to make sure when you're doing things in your life that it is the Lord telling you to do things and not your flesh.
Right.
Because it will come to haunt you.
Right.
It will come back to haunt you.
That's right.
That Ishmael was sent away because Abraham finally had his son, right? From his loyal wife.
Right.
He had his son and Isaac was born and the wife said, "You know, send that son away and his mom." And that nation was a blessed nation. That nation went away. God put a blessing on it. That's where you get Iran and Iraq today. That's who Ishmael is. Israel is over here. Israel's the son of the spirit. The Isaac's son is Israel. You with me?
Yeah.
Jacob was his name, but they turned it into Israel. So you have them two nations, and Ishmael, Joseph's brothers, his brothers, mind you. And I'll talk to you tonight about some brothers who sold me into some slavery.
Yeah.
I told you it's gonna be heavy tonight. You with me? And so anyway, these brothers threw Joseph in a well. You remember the story, Genesis 25, around there, talking about Joseph in prison and all this different stuff. They threw him in a well, his own brothers. And I'm telling you today, you never know. You'll never understand in your heart what it feels like not to be burned by other people or people at work or this and that, but by your own family.
Yeah.
So we don't even know.
Yeah.
You don't even understand what it is, or maybe you have. You with me? But your own family burned you and throw you in a well ready to sell you and then sold you to Ishmael traders? Remember I said it's like if you're in Israel and you're a Jew and they sold you to Saddam Hussein or you know what I mean, one of the Iraqis and they gave you to him to torture and beat you and all this stuff. That's what happened. Joseph was betrayed by his own brothers.
Right.
Who went back with his coat full of blood of a goat and said Joseph was killed so that they could get off the hook with their dad. You with me? Talking about betrayal. Amen?
Yeah.
Jesus' disciples said to him in Matthew 26, I think it was around 26 where they were eating and they were having the Last Supper. And Jesus said, tonight I will be betrayed into the hands of men. And these disciples, one by one, starting with Peter, said, I will never deny you. Yeah. Even if I die with you tonight, Lord. He says, these people here might deny you, but I will never deny you. Listen, all that's good until some swords pulled out on you.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
Come on now. You say you love Jesus all you want, but I'm telling you tonight, somebody came in that door with a gun shooting, you know what I mean, and said, you can leave if you're not a Christian. I'm sure there'd be some of you tonight who say, you know what? Bye. I'm out. Or choose to die tonight by a shooting. Choose, you know, renounce Jesus. I won't renounce him. You'd see some hearts tonight.
Yeah.
Say, I love me more than I love him. I'm out, his pastor. You know, hopefully we'll see you in heaven. You with me? His disciples said, I'll die with you. And they had good intentions. But how many of you ever heard the road to hell is paved with good intentions?
Yeah.
How many of you ever had people say, hey, you know what, I'll be there for you.
Yeah.
I'll back you up.
Yep.
You with me?
Amen.
And then the moment you turn, man, they're back, but they're so far back you can't see them.
Yeah, right.
Hmm?
Yep, that's right.
Amen. Jesus' disciples burned him in the garden. They were gone.
That's right.
He asked them to pray with him. He asked them, I need help. I'm so, you think you've been had anxiety and you know what I mean? The torment in your mind and the devil saying that you think you went through hard times. He was so stressed, he's dropping, he's bleeding. Drops of blood out of his forehead just from the stress he was going through.
That's right.
And he said, man, guys, I need you to pray. Or what he did was he called a prayer meeting.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
And they went to sleep. Amen. And yet in the garden, here comes one of the disciples. Now mind you, 12 disciples were with Jesus the whole time he was ministering. 12 disciples were speaking in tongues. 12 disciples were casting out demons.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
How many of you have been around long enough and you've seen them go with us to Albuquerque, Las Vegas, LA, around the nation, around the world and stuff. And you know what I mean? And God told me one night, he told me, he said, you know, I was preaching before we came back from one of our mission trips on Judas, on this very thing. And I said, man, it's like one of you betraying us and stuff. And man, the moment we got home, all hell broke loose. And I mean, the cities were attacked because of I mean, it was heavy duty, and I'm like, wow, that was heavy duty. That was the spirit of Judas right there in our midst.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Judas came up to Jesus bringing, listen, he got offended.
Yeah.
That's why we deal when we talk about offenses And maybe you don't understand, and we tell you gotta deal with issues and this and that, because the reason I'm saying that is because I'm afraid you're the one that's gonna be bringing the cars.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Right.
You're gonna be the one leading the soldiers to me right here.
That's right.
I know where he lives. Huh?
That's right, man.
Hmm? Right,
he brought the soldiers straight to Jesus. He said, the one who I kissed on the cheek, the one who I've had fellowship with, the one I love, the one that I've been with for 3.5 years.
Amen.
Remember that, 3.5 years. He was with Jesus. Yeah. He preached.
Right.
He went out and laid hands. He cast out devils. He did all this, but see the motives. You know, there's nothing like hard times or conflict to show your true colors.
Yeah.
You with me? And he brings this massive army with torches and swords to an innocent man who had no weapons on him.
Yeah.
He said, why do you come out to me like this? I've only done good for you guys. I've ministered to you, I healed your kids, I did all this stuff. I've done good to you, you come out with an army? And he said, and you came with a kiss?
Yeah.
Kiss is intimacy.
Yeah.
I don't know and I don't see it anymore. But when I was young, we were taught, and sometimes we were made to kiss the elders.
Yeah.
Grandma, grandpa, tia, whoever, and sometimes they didn't smell so good. But I remember my grandfather, and I loved him, and I really didn't know him that well. I'd see him very occasionally, but I remember every time I see him, I remember kissing his face. And it was a sign of love, and it was a sign of respect. I love my grandfather. I sit with my grandfather and I listen to his stories and I love that. But I could imagine Jesus saying, you've always kissed me. Every time we did something, you would come up and you'd kiss me. And this whole time I thought you loved me.
Yeah.
And he said, and you betrayed me. You betrayed me with a kiss. Could you imagine that? You know, I tell people this. I said, you know, it wasn't the cross that killed Jesus. I believe it was a broken heart.
Amen.
Could you imagine right after that, Judas goes, throws his money back at him and said, I didn't want that money. And then he goes and he don't know what to do. And I'm sure the devil was tormenting his mind. And he goes and he hangs himself because that's the only thing he can do to get rid of this torment that he was in now, that I betrayed the only begotten Son of God. Jesus told him it would have been better that you wouldn't have never been born than for you to do what you've done.
That's right.
You with me?
That's right.
And he betrayed Jesus into the hands of sinners, and you know the rest of the story. You with me? But God's showing me this and telling me this. Watch, check this out. Whatever happened to a little thing called loyalty? The definition of loyalty is this. It's the quality of being loyal to someone or something. And one of the examples, and I wrote it down because I liked it, it said that, you know how they give you a little example after what they're talking about? It said her loyalty to her husband of 34 years.
Amen.
Hmm? It also means a strong feeling of support or allegiance.
Amen.
A strong feeling of support or allegiance. How many remember a little thing that says, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America?
Yeah.
Now these days they're burning them.
Yeah.
They're burning them, and you know, there's people that have shed their blood, but there's no more loyalty. There's no more loyalty to a church, there's no more loyalty to God, there's no more loyalty to a nation, to a people who shed their innocent blood for our nation to be free.
Amen.
With me, they treat it so bad. But some of the synonyms of the word loyalty is this, like allegiance, faithfulness. How many of you have ever heard that word?
Amen.
Faithfulness. Amen. Faithfulness doesn't come in spurts, and faithfulness doesn't stop and start, you know, whenever you feel good or whenever you feel religious or anything like that. Faithfulness is something that is in your DNA. Like I said, faithfulness is something you are, not something you do.
That's
Faithfulness is faithful when you don't feel like being faithful. When you, you with me?
Yeah.
Faithfulness is a word that we often hear. This next word blew me away though. You ready?
Yes.
Obedience.
Amen.
Obedience. How many know we want our children to obey?
Yeah.
We want everybody else to obey us.
Yeah.
But we don't want to obey.
That's right.
Loyalty means I'm going to obey you.
That's right,
man. You with me? I'm going to obey my boss. Why? Because I'm a loyal worker.
Amen.
I'm not going to be with the rest of the people over there in the break room gossiping about my boss.
Yeah.
I almost got into a fight with some guy like that. You know what I mean? One time because he was talking about my boss who was not only a sister in Christ, but a fellow Christian, a sister in Christ, but she was my boss and she was my friend. And this guy was a friend of mine too. He was a co-worker, but he was talking against my authority. And I told him, I don't want to tell you what I told him, but I said, if you got so much boldness and all this to talk about her here, go tell her to her face, bro.
Right.
And he started telling me stuff, and that's when I kind of lost it. You with me?
Yeah.
I didn't hit him. I felt like hitting him. I wanted to hit him, but I didn't. Because somebody told me, breathe.
Yeah.
And I breathed, and I went for a walk.
Right.
You with me? But he was coming against my boss. You with me?
Yeah.
And not only, you know, she was a Christian, but you know what I mean? There was a friendship there. See, you know what I mean? It's just in my DNA. You know, no matter where I go, I want to be a loyal person.
Right.
I don't want to be loyal over here at the church, but then when I'm at work or in my, you know, wherever, you know what I mean? I'm not a loyal person. I want to be loyal.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
And that's a Christian DNA, let's just say, okay?
Yeah.
That's not Pastor Vince. That's not his beliefs. No, that's what yours are. If you're a Christian, you should be a loyal individual.
Yeah.
Right.
Allegiance, faithfulness, obedience, adherence. Adherence means you listen to what you're told. Amen.
Yeah.
You're a hearer and you're a doer.
Amen.
Homage. You ever heard they paid homage to Jesus?
Yeah.
And also the last word was devotion.
Amen.
They devoted themselves to the Apostles' Creed and the prayer and to the ministry of the word and to breaking bread with each other. Devoted is not coming to church on Sunday morning. Devotion is an everyday thing. I'm devoted to God. I'm devoted to my family. I'm devoted to my wife. I'm devoted to my church.
Amen.
Devotion doesn't stop when you walk out that door.
That's right.
Or start when you come in.
Yeah.
If you're devoted to Christ, it's 24/7.
Amen.
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 Webster's defines it as fidelity. You ever heard that?
Amen.
You ever talk to my dad? His name is Fidel. He'll give you the whole meaning of fidelity and what it means. And they killed him for what he preached. And he didn't shut his mouth. And my dad's got a mouth that don't stop, man. He'll tell you about this and the Romans and the Italians and the Catholics and all this stuff. And he's like, Dad, calm down, man. Calm down. Cool it. Well, they're going to probably kill me too. You know, and all this stuff, because I'm Fidel, and I'm faithful, you know, stuff like that. It's like, you know, he's got a point. Fidelity, allegiance, fearly, loyalty, devotion, mean faithfulness to something to which one is bound by pledge or duty. Fidelity implies strict and continuing faith, or excuse me, strict and continuing faithfulness, strict and continuing faithfulness, strict and continuing faithfulness to an obligation, trust, or duty. Come on now.
Amen.
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 You don't have to like me. Huh? But you gotta remember who you're faithful,
right.
Who your allegiance is to.
That's right.
It doesn't start with me.
Right.
It starts with the Lord.
Right.
You with me? But you know where you usually find things? Is dealing with individuals.
Yeah, that's right.
You'll find out their heart.
That's right.
You with me? And you know, not just here at church, Some of you are like, no. Let's go to your work and let me talk to some of your coworkers.
Yeah.
How about your boss?
Yeah.
Hmm? Let's go see what they have to say about you.
Yeah.
Not in front of you, but you're not there.
Yeah. Yeah.
To tell me really how they are.
Yeah.
Are you with me? Are they going to say, you know what, they're the same. Man, they're awesome. They're hard workers. They're faithful. On time.
Yeah.
Never miss.
Yeah.
Are they going to, you know, do you really want to know the truth?
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
I believe loyalty is one of the most important qualities of a disciple of Christ.
Amen.
Jesus was and is the most loyal person to ever live. He said this in Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave you nor forsake you.
Amen.
Hmm? Remember hearing that?
Amen.
I will never leave. Not even if I get mad at you. Can I tell you this? That even in the church, people get mad at each other.
Amen.
But true loyalty comes out on the other end when you see. See, I was thinking about this. I said, you know what? Submission, let's just say the word submission, loyalty, commitment, doesn't even begin until there's conflict.
That's right.
How many of you remember standing up here? I love you. Oh, you're so beautiful. You're so handsome. Man, his hair going back. He has to rest for us. He's working. Come on, I love him. I can't wait. I'll put the ring on him. You know what I mean? Oh, it's so good. How many ever watched the movie that Selena or J-Lo did? What is it called where she gets married to that guy and then he starts beating her?
Enough.
I mean, she had a perfect marriage.
Yeah.
She loved him. They were just odd. And then he changed.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
I remember seeing the movie.
Yeah.
He changed and his heart was wicked. He beat her. He would, man, crazy. Almost killed her.
Yeah.
And then she seen his true heart.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
And so submission, loyalty, faithfulness doesn't even begin until there's conflict.
Yeah.
See, everybody loves Pastor Vince.
Amen.
Yeah. They love me until I have to tell them something.
Yeah.
Until I have to check them, like in hockey, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And tell them, hey, listen, Roy, listen, sister, you need to change.
Yeah.
Right now, am I telling the truth?
Yeah.
You talk to Ellen, you talk to Andrea, you talk to any, you know what I mean? And these ladies are faithful, they're committed, they're loyal, but we've been through some stuff.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. We've been round and round.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
And they're still here.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
But we've had some conflict, we've had some issues, and they didn't like that times when Pastor was telling them. Some people in our church have even walked away from our church.
Right.
Only to come back and say, you know what? Wow, I understand now.
That's right, amen.
Let's resolve this issue.
Yeah.
Let's fix it. Why? Because we're loyal.
That's right, amen.
Loyalty don't mean you don't mess up. Loyalty don't mean you don't miss the mark.
Yeah.
Loyalty means you come back. And remember the story of John Mark or the Gospel of Mark.
Yeah.
You ever heard of Mark?
Yeah.
You remember in Acts when Mark went with Paul and Silas, or it was Barnabas and Paul going on mission trips. They took Mark with them, and in the middle of a mission trip, Mark said, I'm homesick. I want to go home. And Paul and them let him go. They said, go home, but don't you ever come back on any of our mission trips. Paul didn't want anything to do with him. Next time there was a mission trip, guess who was wanting to go?
Mark
was wanting to go with Paul and Barnabas. And Paul told him, I will not have you because you're a quitter. I don't want you. You're unloyal. You're not coming in. Him and Barnabas got into some scraps. And Barnabas took John Mark and went one way. And Paul went with Silas a different way. You with me? So there was conflict. But I'll show you in just a minute a portion of scripture where Paul was in prison. And some of his final words, he says, would you please send me Mark over here with me?
Yep.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Send me Mark because I know he's going to help me and he's going to help the ministry.
Right. Amen.
Mm-hmm. So that whenever there's conflict, doesn't mean, you know what I mean? Because, like I said, you know, there's got to be There's got to be, like in your marriage.
Yeah.
Could you imagine every time you got in a fight, you divorced?
Yeah.
You with me? How many know if you've been married or if you're still married, God willing, that there's been some knockdown, drag out, pants flying? Come on now. Now I know you all are just so holy and all that, but sometimes it's bad words and anger and yep. Come on.
Yeah.
And you're like, man, you know what? Even with our kids, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Knock down, drag out, shut your mouth, don't you ever talk to me that stuff, and you know, and you're like,
Yeah.
And then there you go. I remember my daughter, Lisa, she gave me one of the hardest times, man, I ever had growing up. You know, we grow up together. We were teenage parents, me and my wife. But my daughters, you know what I mean, gave me a hard time. I told my daughter a few times, don't you ever come back to this church. I threw her out and this and that. And I guess the next service, she'd be right there on the front row. She's looking at me and I'm looking at her and it's just like, you know, why are you back? You with me?
Yeah.
But you know, even in church, there's conflict and there's this and that. But it's just to prove your heart.
Yep.
It's just to prove and say, you know what? I am. You with me?
Amen.
There, you know, many times you'll see this, even in your own personal life, with your kids, your marriage.
Yeah. Yep.
You with me? Loyalty means till death do us part,
yep.
In sickness and in health.
Yeah.
For better or worse, I was thinking about those the other day. I'm like, that's heavy duty.
Yeah.
No wonder everybody don't want to get married no more. You know?
Yeah.
In richness and in poor, you know, all this stuff. It's like, man, that's heavy duty. I ought to have you make that motto when you come to our church.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Amen.
Say, well, I want to get remarried. Well, you better learn how to be loyal to the Lord first. Because that would be just another Mr. X or Mrs. X if you don't learn how to be loyal.
Yeah.
And realize that no matter what relationship, there's going to be conflict.
Yeah.
And I'm going to love you through the thick and thin, through the hell or high water. You know what I mean? I'm going to make a decision. I'm going to come back. I'm going to bring all my bags back.
Yep.
I'm sorry.
Yep.
Let's work this out.
Amen.
I'm committed to you. Come on. This is good stuff.
Amen.
I woke up the other morning to the thought of those who were supposed to be loyal to me.
Amen.
Those who were supposed to be loyal to me as a leader, or a mentor,
Amen.
As Christian brothers or sisters,
Amen.
Or friends, amen, Christian Amen. Friends, and how they abandoned me when I needed them the most.
Hmm?
I got three examples of them. One was this, let me just tell you, one was of a Christian pastor who was a pastor, evangelist, a mentor, a good friend, a friend that we were tight, man. I've never been that close with somebody I didn't know from the past or anything like that, but man, me and this guy, we bonded. And man, I loved him and he loved me and we were always together. We were on the streets, we were doing Santa outreaches, we were, you know what I mean, we were going into the bars and handing flyers and running out and, you know what I mean, and for years we worked together and we went to the streets and we ministered to youth and stuff like that. And then just one day all of a sudden he got this idea that he's leaving and he's gonna go become this and that. And he just booked. I mean, he didn't even tell me he was gone. He just disappeared, moved his family to a different city to gain access to greater opportunities in ministry and stuff like that. And maybe for him it was a good thing, but you know what I mean? Some of us, we've been through some issues in our past and that abandonment, just like that, no, but nothing said, kind of didn't set right with me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Loved the guy, but it's like, how could he just up and leave?
Yeah.
I thought we were friends. He didn't even tell me.
Yeah.
I'm going, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Just up and gone. You know what I mean? And it was like, and God reminded me that the other morning, I think it was Monday morning, I'm God, why are you reminding me of this? He said, son, you've been abandoned, and I want you to teach on this and teach on these hurts and this stuff that happened to you in your life. And I'm like, man, that's heavy duty, because this guy went away to pursue ministry that was going to help him in his position to go travel around and minister, which was a good thing.
Yeah.
But to me, it was like my best friend just booked.
Yeah.
Didn't even, you know, say bye, nothing, just up and gone and do their own life. And today they travel around, they do this and that, you know, ministry, and they go all over the world and preach and stuff. And occasionally they'll show up here in Pueblo to minister or to do stuff. And you know what I mean? And just recently, you know, we've been a church 20 years, and I think just a few years ago I had them come back and minister in our church. You know what I mean? But it's still that kind of like, you know, dude, you just booked on me.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Another one was a man who, a young man who after 17 years of ministry, my right hand, you with me? Yeah. I mean, it's almost like you're married.
Yeah.
Because they're with you every day.
Yeah.
They grew up in my care. They were with me, you know what I mean, when they were just, you know, rub rats, man. You with me? And growing up, and we loved them, and we took them in as if they were our own kids, our own son. You with me? And we're in our ministry and helped us in everything we did. They were right there with us the whole time. You know what I mean? And all this time, bitterness and anger and stuff, not necessarily in his, but in his wife's heart. And I remember the day, you know what I mean, I scolded them about something that they were ushers and they should have done this and didn't do it and stuff. And it wasn't like I was yelling at them, I was just correcting them. And it just kind of blew up. 17 years, that Sunday prior to that, he got up here after 17 years, and it was our anniversary of our ministry. And said, you know what, I love this ministry, I love my pastors, I love this church, I will never go to another church. The following, well, you know, that was in June, July 4th, I think, was that service.
Yeah.
That it all blew up, and she started yelling at me in front of everybody and said, you know what? I never wanted to be in your church.
Wow.
I never even wanted to be here. I was only here because of him. See, that's the spirit that I'm after. That's the heart, you with me, that I want to cut it off. You with me?
Yeah.
That I want to kill that root. I want to dig that thing out of our church.
Yeah.
You with me? Yeah. And it's not an individual, it's a spirit.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
And there's issues and there's stuff that go inside of us. And instead of dealing or saying something, you know what I mean? We hide them.
Yeah.
And then they walked away from our ministry. Handed me the key.
Yeah.
Walked away. You know what I mean? It's like my whole life shattered.
Yeah.
I mean, anybody else could have left. You know what I mean? And I would have not felt good about it, but it was, you know, I could deal with it. This was like a divorce. Mm-hmm. If you've ever been through a divorce, or I don't know, I'll just say it, maybe some of you have been through some where somebody died.
Yeah.
And it's like, what do you do from here on?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I wouldn't know what to do if my wife passed away. I would freak out. I would, you know what I mean? I wouldn't know how to go on with life.
Yeah.
Because we're one, you know what I mean?
Amen.
And this hit us so hard. And just to walk away, 1 week prior was saying how faithful and committed and how he loved us. How do you walk away from somebody like that? You with me? I mean, it's not like, you know, I mean, if anything, deal with your wife.
Yeah.
If anything, deal with her heart.
Yeah.
Hmm? But it was just, it was crazy.
Right.
And it left me devastated, and it took me a while to mourn this loss.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had people, hundreds of people walk away from our church, but never like this. Never somebody so close, almost like my son.
Amen.
Just up and walking away from our church. And the thing was, is that the church that they're in today is the very one who was talking about us to a group of pastors who all gathered together. That's why I don't have a lot to do with these pastors. Because they gather together, and a lot of times it's gossip, and it's puffing up your chest and saying how big your church is and how successful you are and making fun of the little guys. I was one of the little guys that they were making fun of in one of their groups. And this pastor that he's under now happened to be the very pastor that came to our church on a Christmas program.
Amen.
And we had everybody, you know what I mean? We have everybody in the drama. And there was a few people like there is right now, and they took that and went back and were making fun and poking fun at our church about, you know, we don't even have nobody and all this different stuff, you know what I mean? And it's like, you don't need to hear that when you're going through stuff.
Yeah.
But these pastors were laughing and mocking at this man's jokes. And this is the very man that this guy I'm talking about went underneath and supports today. The other day we drove by there, we were just going that way, we drove by and his truck's there. Faithful. Every day, helping, serving in that church. You with me? And dealing with stuff like that is like, how do you betray me with a kiss?
Yeah.
The very one who you even mocked.
Yeah.
This man mocked that pastor when say, shh, that church is dead and all this stuff today is the supporting pillar. Elder.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
And how do you deal with issues like that? How do you deal with a betrayal like that? It was when Jesus died up on that cross, I believe.
Right.
I can't believe he did that to me. You with me?
Yeah.
It's kind of like those of you that maybe have been through a divorce.
Yeah.
Realize your spouse was out cheating on you the whole time or whatever, and it's your heart is just broken and busted.
Yeah.
How do you recover from that? You with me? Some people never do.
Right.
But see, with God's help and with God's faith, remember, no matter who left you, who betrayed you, who did this, he said this, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's what he said. People may abandon you. People may walk away from you. Maybe even your own children, your own spouse, some of your parents, whatever it is. Remember, he says, even if your mother and father leave you and forsake you, he says, I, the Lord, will never leave you nor forsake you. How much closer can you get with your own mother and father walking away and abandoning you?
Right.
Some of you understand that.
Yeah.
You understand, how can my parents walk away from me and leave me as a little kid to fend for myself? And, you know, whatever it was, maybe grandma's house or foster homes and all this. Yeah. You know what I mean? And it's like Jesus said, you know, it may even come to that where your own mother and father would, because they're lost, forsaken.
Yeah, that's right.
But he said, you can count on me, baby. I'll be there for you, even when nobody else is there for you. See, that's why I serve him and not human beings.
Amen.
That's why I serve him and not people.
Amen.
You with me? I serve people because they serve him.
Amen.
You with me? Because he'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me.
Amen.
The last one I want to talk to you about is we were talking, Manuel, about Bible college and stuff. And he was asking me about the Bible college and different stuff. And this last one is a couple who were in our Bible college. A couple who really didn't come to our church, but who I really felt had a call of God on them, and I still do. These people came to our Bible college and for 3 years. Plus services too, they come to some of our services and they were a part of our family, they were a part of our life for 3 years. They came and every Tuesday night for 3 hours I imparted my heart and my soul into this couple. And I believe that he should have been a pastor. I believe God should have raised him up. You with me? And all this stuff, but after this devastation happened in our church because of this man I was telling you about, that he left our church after 17 years, well, the group, because he split our church right down the middle.
Yeah.
And these individuals who were with him, sister and brother-in-laws and certain individuals, they also left our church because, you know, birds of a feather flock together, and it's kind of good, you know, you want the... Take them all, man. I'd rather start fresh and new than have a bunch of rebels in our church who you raise up and then burn you and pull the carpet off from under you again. Take them all, man. Because if you want cancer, if you have cancer, you don't want to say, well, we got 90% of it. No, get back in there, get the 10 out.
Yeah.
And these individuals left our church and caused us much harm. They said a lot of stuff and they hurt us pretty bad. Well, this group, this couple from the Bible college, they were friends of ours and stuff, and they had a New Year's Eve thing. And who did they invite? Just the people who left our church. They didn't invite anybody else from our church or anything like that, but they invited just these individuals. And I was like, what? They should have been here with us. If anything, having our New Year's Eve here with us.
Yeah.
Them, not them, the couple.
Yeah.
And so one day I was talking to the lady, the wife, and I said, hey, you know what? I said, I just wanted to talk to you, and I wanted to let you know, you might not understand what happened in our church. I said, but you know that other night you had this thing without letting us know, you know what I mean? You had this party, invited the people from the church and stuff, and I said, I just wanted you to know that these individuals are the ones that hurt us really bad. You know, and you know, you had them at your house, and I just wanted to let you know, what they did and who they were. And they were the very ones you had there. And this woman went off on me, man. She told me, what kind of pastor are you? You're supposed to walk in love and forgiveness and all this stuff. And she had no idea what had happened, you know what I mean, and with these individuals. But she tore me up one side, down the other, had me all over Facebook, talking about me and all this different stuff. You know what I mean? And it's like, wow. After 3.5 years, I said, man, we've loved you. We've nurtured you. We've helped you. We've blessed you. I imparted my heart to you and your husband.
Yeah.
And she told me, she said, you know what? You're not going to tell me what to do. Nobody, not even my husband, will tell me what to do. If I want to have a child molester in my home, I will have a child molester. And I'm thinking, what in the world? What are you saying? With your kids there?
Yeah.
You'd have a different idea if they were molesting your children.
Yeah.
I said, but no, that's not the point. But she went off and all this stuff. And man just cut us off. And I was like, wow, you know what I mean? Talk about, you know, dealing with issues and dealing with problems and being burned and being hurt. You know what I mean? I said, man, that's heavy duty.
Yeah.
Having to go through that and then see them. You know, and the sad part is, I don't even think they're serving the Lord today.
Oh,
I think they're drinking and doing all that stuff, you know what I mean? And I hope that's not the case. I hope they're in church, but, you know what I mean? I even still love them. I even still pray for them. And I would even help them today if they came over here. You with me? And I've told them that. I've told the man that. Messed up, jacked up, and I told him, you know what? You still have a call on your life. And if you need me, I'm here to call me, I'll help you, whatever it is, you know what I mean? And it's like, you know, dealing with disloyalty.
Yeah.
What is loyalty? What is, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's heavy duty, man.
Yeah.
Trying to deal with these issues, amen?
Yeah.
I'm not telling you because they're fresh in my heart. You know what I mean? God had already dealt with me. I'm over this, but God is like, you know what I mean? He wants me to let you know this. You know what I mean? Because I think some of you think you're the only ones going through it.
Right, yeah.
And we've been through hell and back. Jesus was the greatest example of what it is to be betrayed and resurrect from that betrayal.
Right.
You with me? And to teach us what it is to be loyal. Amen? We've had a church for 20 years now. And have helped many people. If you've been around, you know.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Many people who have in turn burned us,
yeah,
hurt us,
yeah,
and abandoned us. Amen. After we loved them, trusted them, and helped them.
Right.
You with me?
Amen.
And listen, I'm not trying to play on sympathy. I'm not trying to get your sympathy either. I'm just trying to prove a point to you. I'm trying to show you something.
Yeah.
Amen. Let me give you some other stuff here. What has happened to that one? What has happened to that one? And most important quality of a Christian. The quality of loyalty. It's important that you understand this. Because if you don't understand loyalty, you'll betray Christ Himself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yeah.
You had it in the world.
Yeah. That's right.
How many were loyal to your drug dealer,
right,
the liquor store,
right,
the come on now,
right,
your exes and
yeah,
everybody,
yeah,
you're all faithful and loyal and committed to
right,
the wrong.
Yeah. Right.
And you know, and what cheers me out is when I work with people who were gang members, And they come into the church, and I've had them come in by the hundreds, and they do not understand. Once they get saved, God requires even more than your gang did.
Yeah, yeah.
He requires loyalty.
Yeah.
The sangre por sangre, homeboy.
Yeah.
Blood in, blood out.
Yeah.
I'm dying for my body, all this stuff, right?
Yeah.
Then you get saved. Why didn't you come to church, Holmes? Well, I had a cold, Pastor. And I didn't have any NyQuil. And so when I tried this other remedy, and it didn't work, and I didn't feel very good, so I couldn't come. Come on, now.
Yeah.
How many know the party was on? You were there, Smokoso, and Roñoso, and walking 10 blocks to the party, and the ice, and the below zero, and all this stuff. Faithful, loyal.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you get saved. Come on, now.
Hmm?
You see it in the gangs. You see the loyalty. What is the one defining mark of a true Christian believer? Loyalty. Let's see. Revelations 12:11. Maybe some of you remember this. Remember the scripture, Revelation 12:11? And they overcame, or they have defeated him by the blood of the Lamb and the word and their testimony. And I put this in parentheses, and they did not love their lives so much that they were afraid, they weren't afraid to die.
Right, man.
If you look at the book of Hebrews in the 11th chapter, right in the middle of it, you're going to see people that were willing to die. There was people that were fed to lions and told, all you got to do is renounce Christ. How many of you ready to go to the lion's den for Jesus?
Yes.
Heck no. I got to work in the morning, Pastor. And it's Friday, and it's my last day before Christmas break. I'm not going to no lion's den. Well, what happened to the loyalty?
Right.
What happened to they loved not their lives even to shrink from death?
Right.
What happened? You had it in the world. Where did it go?
Yeah.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
Let me tell you about this guy named Demas in Colossians chapter 4, verse 14. I said this, Demas at one time was a disciple of and a co-worker with Paul in the ministry. Colossians 4:14 says this. Paul was talking to the people, to the Colossians, and he said this. He said, Luke, he said, the beloved doctor sends his greetings. He said, oh, and so does Demas. Philippians 4:123. I'm just kind of setting you up here. Philippians 1:23, or Philemon, excuse me, Philemon 1:24. Says, or 23 and 24, it says, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you his greetings. And so does Mark. Uh-oh, there's Mark. Demas, and Luke, my co-workers. So he's telling them, hey, listen, my co-workers here on the mission field are sending you their greetings. But then he switches up here in 2 Timothy 4:9, and this is Paul's final words to Timothy. Almost like you're on your deathbed.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever been around that and people are starting to speak their last final words and you're kind of like straining so you can hear what they have to say?
Yeah.
Check out what Paul says in 2 Timothy 4:9. Timothy, please come as soon as you can. Demas, remember Demas?
Mm-hmm.
My friend, my co-worker? Mm-hmm. In the gospel, he said, Demas has deserted me because he loved the things of this life and has gone to Thessalonica. Demas abandoned him. Demas left him there. Look what it says. It continues on. It says, Crescens has gone to Galatia and Titus has gone to Dalmatia. And he said, only Luke is with me. Bring Mark. There it is. Bring Mark with you. Remember the one he didn't want around?
Yeah.
He proved him and he said, you know what? Mark is a loyal. Bring Mark. Because Mark won't leave me. Watch what he says. Bring Mark with you. He says, when you come. He says, for he will be helpful to me in my ministry or my church, right? Yes. He said, I sent Titus to Ephesus. He says, when you come, be sure to bring the coat that I left with Carpus at Treos. And he said, and bring my books. And especially my papers. He said, Alexander, now watch, he's talking about somebody here, look. Alexander, the coppersmith, he did me much harm. He says, but the Lord will judge him for what he has done. He says, be careful of him. Amen?
Amen.
My pastor's warned me about men as well. About certain individuals, be careful of them people.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
Sometimes we just ignorantly, you know, we ignore it and get in some trouble.
Yeah.
Amen? He said, let's see where I am. Be careful of him, for he fought against everything that we said. There's people that will fight against us, that whatever we're preaching to you, they'll come against us. Christians and even pastors. The first time I was brought before the judge, no one came with me.
Right.
He says, everyone, what?
Deserted me.
Everyone deserted, everyone abandoned me. He said, may it not be counted against them. He says, but the Lord stood with me. Thank God for Jesus.
Yeah.
But the Lord stood with me and gave me strength so that I might preach the gospel, the good news in the entirety. He said, for all the Gentiles to hear. And he rescued me from certain death. Yes, and the Lord will deliver me from every evil attack and will bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. All glory to God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Watch what I wrote here. I put this. I said, Paul here was writing to Timothy, his spiritual son. How many want to protect your kids?
Yes.
This was his spiritual son. He was writing to him about certain unloyal men. Watch this. Today, the people in the church would not call this, or would not call this a warning of to look out for unloyal men, but gossip. He's judging me.
Yeah.
How can he say that about me? Alexander the coppersmith, who done harm. How Paul's gossiping about us over there. No, Paul was warning him.
Yeah.
Paul was warning him, and there's certain people that maybe one day I'll warn you about.
Yeah.
Maybe sometimes it'll be him, and years later you're married, you say, I wish you would have listened to his warning.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or individuals who maybe, do you know that some of this stuff that I was talking about, especially with the guy that was here 17 years and stuff. You know, years and years when we started our church, before he ever got married, the Lord told me, he says, man, you know, that spirit was right there. It was right there the day that man said, if you don't let me marry this woman, I'm leaving your church. And instead of saying, go, I mean, we didn't have a lot of people. I'm like, dude, don't leave, let me work with you. Let me help you. Let me, you know, I mean, I was trying to love him and I was trying to do what I thought was right at the time. And had I known, I would have said, then, adios. But it took 17 years for that seed to grow into something that was vicious enough to come against me and to harm me more than anything else. You with me? And it was like, had I listened to the Holy Spirit back then, when the rebellion started, and cut it, remember I said, cut that root,
yeah.
I wouldn't have probably faced some of the stuff I did in the ministry.
Yeah.
But sometimes, you know what I mean, well, he's cute and handsome, and I love him. I'll change him, Pastor, I promise. All right. Pastor said, no, don't do it.
Yeah.
No, yo, I didn't see that the way you really was until you have enough, like J-Lo. He said, you know what, I'm tired of being beat up and all this stuff. Man, I should have listened. You know how many people that have written letters from prison, you know, for years since, and someone said, Pastor, had I only listened to you?
That's right.
You with me? What you said wasn't wrong. I was wrong.
Yep.
That's a trip. The people of the church look to the pastors and say, you're wrong in what you're saying. We're right. Huh?
Right.
We'll pastor ourselves. Huh? Amen. Let me finish up. I'm almost done here. I just got a few more things. Okay. I already read that. What happened to the spirit of Christ? The spirit of loyalty, faithfulness. You listening?
Yeah.
What happened to the spirit of Christ? The spirit of loyalty, faithfulness, allegiance, commitment. You with me?
Yeah.
What happened to this, or as I put it, now watch, as I put it back in the day, I'm with you till the hubcaps fall off, baby.
Right.
Or the way they say it, today's vocab, they say it's ride or die.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Yep.
What happened to that? What happened to that trans? You know, they said, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. What it's talking about is a transformation from an ugly worm, or what do you call them?
Caterpillar.
You know how ugly those things are?
Yeah.
Ugly hair and all kinds of stuff. Yeah. You, I don't want to touch it. To a beautiful butterfly, man, that you look, man, you want to take pictures, the colors are so beautiful. What happened in the transition, in the cocoon?
Yeah.
¿Qué pasó con el vato loco? ¿Qué pasó con crazy girl?
Yeah.
La loca, la spider, la dimple, you know what I mean? What happened in the transition to the, you know what I mean, ready to take a bullet for your gang?
Yeah.
To your Christians who would betray your brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
What happened in the transition there? I don't understand it.
Yeah.
Because that's why God saved you.
Yeah.
He's seen that crazy dude that would run after 50 men by himself, talking about, come back here, I'll take all you want. Yeah. And the Lord is like, check him out. That dude's nuts. Save that man right there. He'll take the world for Jesus. And something happened in the transition. Now we're running, you know what I mean, from our wives and everybody else.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Something happened in that transition, and what was supposed to happen was that you were supposed to become better on the other end.
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
God's seen that. Die hard.
Yeah.
How many days? How? Partying, smoking meth, all jacked up. How many days is the longest, huh?
Probably 7.
7 days. Could you imagine having a 7-day service?
Man.
So, come on, in the spirit, we don't go home and they ask you at work, where were you last week? Man, we had church. We couldn't get enough. Pastor preached, Pastor Susan preached, some of the other people got up, testified, we sang for 7 days. We, you know what I mean, it was a glorious time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ah, seven minutes and you...
That's right.
You know?
Right,
man. How many of you used to ever go out in the Royals and the back alleys and go find Kagers and come on, man. You go find the party, I mean, in the middle of nowhere.
That's
Who was it, Al? Me and you were driving one day, right there by Eagle Ridge where we live, and she's the pastor. Right there is where I used to go out and party in that desert, that Arroyo. I'm like, what? There's houses there now. But she's, man, I remember that. Man, we partied there, we partied. I was like, wow, Sammy Duty. We find them in the middle of nowhere, but we can't find 1010 Troy Avenue. We try. Come on now. What happened to our loyalty? Amen. Where is the lie? Amen.
Amen.
Jesus is the loyal. Jesus is loyal.
Amen.
His true followers are loyal.
Amen.
He and they would rather die than abandon you.
Hmm? Right. Amen.
Be loyal to the Lord.
Amen.
To your pastors and your ministry.
Amen.
And to the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Even if it costs you your life.
Right. Amen.
Mm?
Amen.
Even if it costs you everything.
Yep.
Mm? Amen. That's the kind of God we serve.
Amen.
I don't think I'd want to be affiliated with unloyal people.
That's right.
You with me?
Amen.
I'd rather, man, go ahead and find your own praise. I'm sure they got some seats over there for you too. Huh? I'm sure they got some over there where Brother Elder is over there. They probably got some seats for you there too.
Yeah.
You with me? Or anywhere else you look, there's probably seats there.
Yep.
You with me? And it's like, why? Because, you know what I mean? If you want our loyalty and you want to just check in, check out, get a quick service and, you know what I mean, get a quick blessing and say, I went to church today, whatever. You know what I mean? That's not the God that why would God send him sent to a cross for you to have some quick check-in and check-out.
Yeah. Right.
This is, see, he said, deny yourself.
Yeah.
Take up your cross and follow me.
Amen.
Follow my example.
Amen.
His example led in suffering, sacrifice, and finally to the cross on Calvary.
Amen.
You with me? That's his example. You say, I ain't got time for that, I'm busy. Come on now.
Yeah.
I got this, I got plans, I got this, you know what I mean? All this stuff. And it's like, you know, I just want to get back to that place where really everybody that serves the Lord is just a loyal individual.
Right.
They're loyal.
Amen.
I don't believe God sends you to all the churches in Pueblo.
Right.
I don't believe you hit all the churches and you're gonna find another one, that's church hoppers.
Yeah.
I believe that just like a wife, God wants you to have one church.
Yeah,
not 10 wives.
Right.
Not 10 husbands.
Right.
You with me?
Yes.
One.
That's right.
The husband of one wife. The husband, you with me?
Yeah.
The wife of one husband. Not, she's been with every boy in Pueblo, and you're the one that gets stuck with her, man.
Yeah.
Hmm?
Right.
And I believe that God has sent you to one church until he sends you out from that one church.
Right.
To be faithful, to be loyal, to be committed, to serve, to help, to, you with me?
Yeah.
More than anything, listen, somebody said today, I was watching a thing by Creflo Dollar, he said, God's more interested in your loyalty than he is your gifts and your talents.
Right.
He said, I would rather have a loyal individual than somebody gifted and talented.
Yeah.
Because them are usually the ones, he says, that are the rebellious ones. Because they float on their gifts and their talents and their abilities, not on loyalty,
right.
Not on faithfulness,
amen.
Not on the heart of Jesus Christ. Could you imagine if Jesus came and went whenever he felt like it? Whoops, I can't get you this week.
Yeah.
You with me? He said, I'll never leave you. No matter who leaves you in life, he'll be right there by your side. That's why you need to serve Jesus.
Amen.
You with me? You need to serve Jesus. Give him your whole heart, give him your life. Amen?
Amen.
God is looking for you. I mean, how many, could you imagine the dog? Dogs are loyal.
Yeah.
You could be gone for weeks and you come back and they're saying, they're just happy to see you.
Yeah.
God, not your wife. She'd be like, will you be cochino malaco? Get out of here. Use your clothes. They're shredded and torn and burned and everything else and run you over several times. That dog. I missed you. I'm so glad to see you. I love you. At that time, that's when you said, man, I'd rather have this dog. Thank you, Jesus. God is looking for loyalty.
Amen.
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 Stand with me tonight.